Yeah, this reminds me of, and I think I mentioned on the show before, back in 2003, Paul Krugman, you know, the Nobel Prize winning economist. Nobel Prize winning economist made the point that we should, he said something along the lines of, I hope that, it's 2003, I hope that they create a real estate bubble just like they did a tech bubble. It'll be great, you know, or something like that. And, you know, lo and behold, he got his wish, you know. So now Obama wants to do it again, create another bubble.
Yeah, let's get another $1 trillion in debt, huh? Yeah, this guy comes in, we're $5 trillion in debt. He comes in when we're $5 trillion in debt. Now we're $14 trillion in debt. Great job. Yeah, you got it worked out. Yeah.
But as you were discussing in saying, it's like that disenfranchises the poor. It increases rent. You know, this is not a solution.
Oh, so we're here with Harry Alford with the National Black Chamber of Commerce. Hey, I had one quick question for you, Harry.
Sure.
And then I want you to kind of tell us a little bit about, you know, how we can find you on the web and any events you have coming up or anything like that. But have y'all done any real good research, or do you follow pretty closely the whole concept of entitlements? I mean, obviously, you know, the black community is you know, has a stake in that, just like all the rest of us do. So, what kind of positions do you guys have, or what kind of policies do you promote for you know, Medicare, Medicaid?
Yeah, my personal experience of entitlements, you know, and I look at my family, my parents, my aunts and uncles, and my grandparents, how that strong family knit was there. You know, you go back to Louisiana every summer, and you had these family reunions, and there was order. You know, grandma and granddaddy would speak, and it was law. And everybody was in awe. And then the parents and then the children, but everybody minded the next generation above them.
Sure.
And then in the 60s with the Great Society, some of my cousins decided that they didn't need papa and mama and grandpa and grandma. They had the government that would send them a check. And they didn't have to get married. They could have children on their own. And the government would give them a bigger check for each child. And to where it started disintegrating. And then we saw my cousins in Louisiana moving to Los Angeles or moving up to Chicago because the welfare checks were bigger in Chicago and L.A. from Louisiana.
Right. Sure.
And it created – and then their children lived in these squalor-type communities and would end up going to jail, pushing drugs, to where it destroyed – a family chain to where, you know, and here we are, my generation, we were lawyers, first time being college educated, lawyers and doctors and going into professional services. And then this other group underneath us was going backwards because they could sit back and get that check and be happy. And it is sad. The war on poverty was the war for poverty. And it created a poverty class.
It's a war of dependence, you know.
Yeah.
That's what it's about.
The government dull. So sad.
Well, tell us, hey, real quick, I want you to tell us what you have coming up. I do have a shameless plug. Our good friend Kenneth McClinton, who I'm sure you've corresponded with, because, well, nobody gets on our show unless they talk to Ken first. So he's got an event coming up on June 9th. In D.C., and the topic is Medicare, Medicaid. Are you in town around then, or do you know?
Yeah, I'm on the U.S. Chambers Board. We have a board meeting here in town on the 8th, so yeah, I'll definitely be in town.
All right, well, I'm going to have Ken get in touch with you. I'd like for you to speak for a few minutes, if you just kind of tell us your thoughts on the topic. But we'll do that another time. We'll do that offline.
Mm-hmm.
But tell us what you guys have coming up and what we can do to support the National Black Chamber.
Yeah, we got a trade mission going to Kenya June the 12th to the 17th, Nairobi, and we're going back to be our fourth trip to Kenya. They've got a constitution now. They're working on a true democracy, and we're really encouraging the Kenyans to go. They thought, you know, being that the president's blood was from Kenya, that they were going to have a good friend in him. But, you know, a disappointment once again. But we're going to move ahead anyway. But our annual convention, Our annual convention is July 21st to 23rd in Miami, Florida, at the Four Seasons Hotel. We've got a rate for $150 a night at a five-star hotel. We're going to have a dynamite list of speakers, programs, talking about entrepreneurship, and what we can do to move America further down the line of greatness.
Excellent, man. Well, I really appreciate you coming on.
I have one last question, though.
I'm really curious.
What do you think about a Mitch Daniels Condoleezza Rice ticket?
Ooh, baby. Oh, that would be a hot one. Yeah, and I know Mitch personally. I said, my wife's from Indianapolis, and I knew Mitch when he was working for Eli Lilly, and he was a good friend of Mayor Stephen Goldsmith, who was a great friend of mine and who I admire. And I knew Mitch when he was at O&B under George W. Bush, and we had some good chats. He knows how to handle a dollar. He knows how to handle a budget. And Mitch says, you know, I came up with this great invention when I became governor. I wouldn't spend more than we brought in.
And it worked.
Well, I mean, it's the perfect ticket because, like you say, he knows how to manage the domestic affairs. And Condi is, you know, an absolute
There's no one more brilliant than Condoleezza Rice, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, did you hear that Laura Bush paid a visit to Mrs. Daniels and I think to Mr. Daniels is basically like, hey, we might be able to get you Condi. Did you hear about that? I'm very excited.
I would stump. I would raise money. I would work. I would spend money.
Wait a minute. I don't want you to get in trouble, man. This is a nonpartisan, you know, organization.
This is Harry Alford talking, not the chamber. This is Harry Alford talking.
Yeah.
I like that change of the hat.
Yeah, we would. Oh, gee, I got to think about that. If that happens. Let me bring up a big point here.
Sure, go ahead.
African Americans, we voted 97%.
Oh my God, is it 97%?
For Obama, myself included. I was biased. I voted for him because he was black, and I wanted to see America with a black president. So we did. Okay, fine. But the hope that was promised is not hiring. The hope isn't turning things around, and now. This time, 2012, we got to think about what's best for our nation, and not the symbolism. So
I won't hold you to this, obviously, and it's not scientific. But if you had to guess of the people you've talked to, you know, out of that 97%, how many of them are scraping Obama stickers off their car now?
Oh, listen, when I first started questioning the policies, I would get blowback. Boom! No. Now I'm starting to get a lot of nods.
Yep.
I'm starting to get a lot of, and you know, our biggest growth, I was doing an analysis of our new membership. The biggest growth we have in America is coming from the greater Chicago region.
Mm-hmm.
Because
people
are hurt. They are hurt. Yeah. They have been disappointed. They have been betrayed. And they're hurting. Mm-hmm. America is hurting like never before.
I saw an article yesterday, I think, that said that black males have the highest unemployment today than they ever have.
In history.
That, you know, and I too, you know, I didn't vote for Obama, but I did have, you know, hope that for the black community that he would be that, you know, role model that a lot of kids needed to say, hey, you know, it's just not worth selling drugs on the street. I'm going to go work at McDonald's.
Did you hear about the Congressional Black Caucus last Thursday?
Oh,
no.
They took that report to the White House and asked his presidency, what are we going to do about this? And they walked, according to the Huffington Post, the liberal Huffington Post, they walked out of the White House shaking their heads.
Really?
He was blasé. He gave no encouragement whatsoever. That's dangerous.
He doesn't care about businesses. That's what people don't understand. It's not evil. It's just wrong.
It's wrong. And it's the philosophy.
Is it true that Valerie Jarrett's the one running the White House anyway and that it's not really Obama?
Well, whoever's running is messing it up. That's for darn sure.
Yeah, that's for darn sure. Well, thanks again for coming on, and we're going to have you on again.